Hello, hello, and welcome to Let's Chat Sunday. Thank you for tuning in to another episode. This week, before we go any further, make sure you like, subscribe, and share with your family and friends. Our topic for this week is evangelism, and I'm pleased to be joined by some lovely guests. Would you like to introduce yourself and tell us a bit about what you do in church?
Hi, I'm Leandre. I'm one of the pastors at TBC, focusing mainly with Impact. So the young adults also have a preaching ministry as well.
Awesome. I'm Dr. Lisa Ajay, and I genuinely do follow the bishop, just humbly following his lead.
I am not a bishop. let's put that out there.
mainly at the West Norwood branch, just mainly serving in teaching and preaching and helping out where I can. And then, work for an NGO and, do lots of fun stuff on the side.
Fantastic. Well, lovely to have both of you today.
Good to be here.
So let's get stuck in. What is evangelism? If I didn't know anything, mm-hmm. how would you explain evangelism to me?
I would just say it's spreading the good news of Jesus, telling other people that gospel message, that good news of Jesus Christ, that this man over 2,000 years ago came to earth, lived a perfect life, and he died a horrible death. But the reason why he died that death is so that we don't have to. So he died in our place, but 3 days later, with all authority, all power, he came back to life, and now he is in heaven, you know, interceding on our behalf, and has restored our relationship with God. If I was going to say, 30 seconds, but simply, evangelism is telling people the good news of Jesus, mm-hmm. and what that means for them and how that's going to benefit them in their life as well.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think I'd add to that and just say that there's that element of discipleship in there that we encourage and tell people the news of Jesus, and if they take that we bring them on that journey of discipleship, of coming and following Jesus, that it's not just, saying a prayer and saying yes to him, but actually there's a whole lifelong transformation that God does with us on that journey. And sometimes we get the honour and the privilege to do that with someone, or sometimes we're only there for that initial part and then we pass them on to someone else. But I think, there's that holistic view of bringing people onto a journey with Jesus.
It's true. The Great Commission doesn't say, go and make converts, does it?
Yeah.
It definitely go and make disciples.
Definitely. And that would lead me to my next question, which would be, who qualifies as being an evangelist? Some people might
only
say...
Only the bishop.
Some people might say, I don't have the backing. Some people might say, you hear those people that are called, Evangelist Sarah or Evangelist John. Yeah. If I'm not called that, what qualifies me to be able to go out and do that?
I guess I would say, at the end of the day, every single one of us are qualified.
Yeah.
As soon as you're a Christian, you are qualified to tell other people, one, why you're a Christian, and two, why they should be a Christian.
Yeah.
The only qualification you need is to be a Christian.
Yeah.
I think what we should acknowledge, though, that, in Ephesians 4, I believe it is, Paul talks about the fivefold ministry.
Mm.
We have evangelists, preachers, teachers, prophets, and apostles. So there are those individuals who perhaps have an extended grace, have specific gifts and talents for evangelism. It's in their belly. Myself, if I think about the fivefold ministry, it's teacher. Very much someone who wants people to understand the word of God and be empowered by the word of God and strengthened by the word of God. Does that mean I never evangelize? Of course it doesn't. That's nonsense.
Yeah.
But it just means that God has gifted me with that ability to teach and has put that desire in terms of the fivefold.
Mm.
That doesn't mean I don't evangelize. Mm. So every single one of us should evangelize.
Yeah.
We are qualified by the fact that we are a Christian.
Yeah.
However, we understand there are those who perhaps have a greater emphasis on evangelism within their walk with Christ.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I think that, I was saying earlier to you guys that my sister does that so well, that it's, she when she used to come to church, and I was leading a church in Guildford, she would always bring someone with her. She never came alone.
Yes.
That's evangelism, right there. And sometimes we make it this kind of really serious, intense thing that only a few special people can do.
Yeah.
But actually, it's a calling on all of us.
Mm-hmm.
To share, to show kindness, to introduce people to Jesus wherever we go. And so you can do it absolutely anywhere, and that you can take any opportunity that you've got to do that with someone.
And some people, and like you're saying, it's not a one man job.
Yeah.
No one can do it alone.
Even Jesus had a team.
Yeah,
Definitely. So some people might also ask, why should I evangelize? What is it that I need? Why do I need to evangelize? So what would your take be on that?
First and foremost, you know, it's an instruction Jesus has given us. If we look at the Great Commission in Matthew 28, before Jesus ascends into heaven, he's very clear what he wants his disciples to do. You know, go and tell people about me. Make disciples, you know. So we, because Jesus has told us to do it, we have a responsibility to do it. And we know what good it is to be a Christian.
Yeah.
To experience the love of God, the peace of God, you know, it would be wrong not to want other people to also
definitely
have that as
some,
well.
Some might say, though, why should I evangelize? My life is a testimony, you know.
It's some amazing life you're living.
I'm telling you.
No, there might be those that go out and say, you know, I go out and my life is an example. What would you say to those people who don't necessarily want to go outside and, you know, go into Croydon or go into Brixton or go into whatever area? They want that their life is, you know, an example to people. What would you say to those people?
I would say that's a really high standard that you're setting for yourself. And I think that, you know, it's so important that our lives reflect the truth that we say. And all of us are on that journey of following Jesus, of putting our hands up when we get it wrong. Yes. Come on, like, let's not lie.
Yeah.
And actually, you know, allowing God to transform our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can encourage people to come with us as we follow Jesus.
Mm.
But I think saying to people, I am it, like, this is enough.
Yeah.
I think is much harder. And I know that, you know, I know Paul speaks about, you know, our lives being the epistle.
Mm.
That, you know, the gospel is written on. But I think it's so important that we always let people know that that message is Jesus.
Yes.
That it never stops at us. And so, yes, I want to live in a way that reflects everything that I say and I mean. But I also want to be able to say to people, it's Jesus. It's Jesus has done this in me.
Yes.
You know, this testimony of his goodness is amazing, but it's not me. Like, don't ever get it twisted. It's not. It's not me. Or if not, we're pointing people to us and putting ourselves on a pedestal. And saying that I am now the way and I'm not. Jesus is the way, you know? And so being really clear about that, that my life reflects the truth, but I'm actively pointing people to the one who actually saves is so important.
Definitely.
And that's what Paul says. He says, you know, follow me as I follow Christ.
Yeah.
He doesn't just say follow me.
Yeah.
Because he understands that. Because, you know, that would be a problem.
Yeah.
He understands the benchmark is Christ. If we think about, you know, what the word gospel means, it means good news.
Yeah.
And news is never something that is acted out. It's something that is spoken, it's something that is declared. Even if you watch, you know, ITV, Sky, BBC, the news, they don't act out what's happening in terms of current affairs. It's something that they speak
definitely.
And they declare. So there's a responsibility on us to be able to confidently say and talk about Jesus, say it's because of him, because of what he's done for me, and be able to do that rather than, like Lisa's saying, directing people to us. We want everyone to be led to him.
Yeah. Definitely. And I also, when we get it wrong, it means we're free to say so.
Yes.
You know, or like, do I not evangelize because I'm not in a good place? You know, all of that starts to come undone when we're making it all about us. It means that, you know, if I'm fantastic and I feel fantastic about my walk with God, great, I'm going to evangelize. If not, then I'm not. Like that becomes too dependent on us.
Yeah, which leads me actually to the next question, which would be, there might be some people who say they don't know enough. What if they don't know enough? How do I go out there and then preach it? You know, I can experience it, but I might not have the answer to everybody's question.
Yeah.
So if that stops me, what encouragement would you give to people to go and do that?
Say what you know.
Yes.
You know, start with what you know. Start with the truth that you know, you know, and people can always tell when you're telling the truth.
Mm.
You know, if I come here, I'm like, guys, I love Sprouts. Like, you know full well I'm lying. You can see it in my eyes. But start with the truth that you know and you believe, you know, and if it's the basic gospel, it's the gospel that saves. So, you know, who Jesus is, what he did for us, the joy of that. Start there, you know, and if people have questions, that's okay that you can't answer. That's absolutely fine. You know, you're not all of us are apologists. Some people have that gifting, some people have that calling. Some of us, we don't have that intellectual academic, you know, I know why this verse is that's
fine.
People
don't need that.
And they don't care.
Everyday guy or girl on the street doesn't need all of that. They just need what you're saying. They need to know about what Jesus has done for them.
And that he loves them and he cares and that he's for them, you know. And I think sometimes that fear of someone's going to ask me a question I'm not going to know stops us from even sharing what we know.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes you know more than you do. You yes. know, the stories of Noah and Moses, they're all a part of the gospel. They're all a part of what God is doing to save us and bring us back to him.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And I would just say, if what you know saved you, what makes you think is not going to save someone else at the end of the day?
Definitely.
And God will do the increase. He will multiply. God will put in your spirit also what to say.
Yeah.
All God wants is willing vessels. And God will do the rest at the end of the day. So it's not a case of, it, or even if you feel like, you know, you don't know enough, learn more.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
know
for
more.
A reason.
Know
yeah.
more. So that you then feel more confident and equipped to go out and do what God's called you to do.
No, definitely. Some people might say that they've been out there and they've been rejected. Some people might have a fear of rejection and say, I don't want to go outside and go and speak to people. Because they might say to me, you know, they might ask me a question that I don't know and then reject me.
Yeah.
Or they might just outright reject me.
Yeah.
What would you say to those people who are thinking about it or those that have done it and they're feeling a bit rejected?
Dash yourself off and try again, start again. I think it's a really important part of our journey and our walk. That Christ even says that when we are rejected, we're following in his steps.
Yes.
We're
yeah.
following in his way. And so I think that there's something about us embracing this as Christians.
Yes.
That actually a part of following Jesus means we're not going to be accepted by everyone.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean everyone's going to reject us, but we're not going to be accepted by everyone. And so being, you know, learning that actually it's not personal, that it's not, you know, hopefully you're not shouting at people and being rude and that's why they're rejecting you. But hopefully it's not personal. It's actually people don't want to hear the truth or their eyes have been blinded to the truth. But I think also just getting into a place where you practice, the more you practice, the more you get used to, you know, being able to experience that and, you know, go back and pray and be like, oh God, what was going on? Did I say something wrong? You know, what was it? And learning to pick yourself back again, you know. And when you watch kids learning how to walk, they fall all the time.
Yeah.
They walk into doors, they trip over stuff, they trip over their own feet. But no child stops there.
Yes.
No child's like, I'm done. Like, I fell, I'm done. They get up and they have another go. And I think we've got to get into the habit of having another go and just keep going one foot in front of the other.
Yeah.
And we'll get better at it.
Yeah.
We'll see fruit from it. But we'll still always experience that rejection because it's not about us. It's about the truth that they're rejecting as a part of it.
Exactly, and we're not the ones who do the saving.
Mm,
you know, you can feel that you have nailed it. The gospel, from Genesis to Revelation, you've not missed anything out. You've not stuttered. Everything's been perfect. But that person might still say no to Jesus.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
you may evangelize to someone else, and you may feel like, oh, I didn't mention this, I didn't mention that, I didn't mention this. And that person is going to take Jesus because at the end of the day, it's God who saves.
Definitely.
It's a spirit who draws people onto himself. So we just have to be those willing vessels again. And then God will ultimately do the rest. So rejected or not, that's not an indictment on our ability to evangelize. You know, our ability to evangelize is just to be a willing vessel who's going to communicate the gospel to other people and then just pray people into heaven after that.
So what would be your final sort of bits of encouragement to people who are thinking about it, who have done it, and like I said, they, you know, they've stopped. What would be your encouragement to them?
Have a go. Get started, have a go. As my brother was saying, it's not a suggestion. It's actually a commandment that God gives us, and it should come from a place of love. That if you found £1 million and you found a way to get £1 million and anyone could do this, why would you keep it to yourself? Like, why would you sit on that? You know, and if I was sat next to you, I'd be like, you're well stingy. That, you know, you found that way and you kept quiet about it. And so, you know, the Bible calls the kingdom of God a treasure. You found treasure. You found the source of life. You found a way to live that makes sense and that is good for you in every possible way. Why would you keep that to yourself, you know? And so get started in sharing. You can do that in so many different ways. You know, using your gifts and talents, using your voice, using your opportunities, using your relationships and your friendships. But just get started. And like that kid, if you get mess it up, if you get it wrong, just get back up again and keep going. You know, that it's not as detrimental as we think it is. We think sometimes it's over, but it's not.
Like, God's not bigger than that.
Yeah.
What would your final bit of encouragement be to...
Be creative. You know, we live in an age of social media. You know, so even like myself, I'm not a confrontational person. I can be quite introverted. So, you know, finding me just go up on the street and tell someone about Jesus is highly unlikely. However, I will use my social media and the relationships I have to tell people about Jesus. You know, so whether on IG you're doing, you know, the scriptures you're sharing, whether it's, you know, you're on your Snapchat, little videos of the service you're in, of worship, of the preaching. So using, you know, the avenues you have to talk about Jesus.
Definitely.
So rather than to glorify yourself, you know, use them to glorify Jesus. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, rather than, you know, always talking about, you know, your accomplishments, you know, selfies, all that kind of stuff, which are all good, but also using those avenues to tell people about Jesus. See how many likes that gets, how many reposts, how many retweets that gets as well. Because I think that's also a powerful way for us to communicate. If you've got 1,000 followers, you know, one message, one post, one status, 1,000 people have heard the gospel.
Definitely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Definitely. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, indeed.
And thank you for tuning in. We hope that you are blessed by this discussion and that you're encouraged to go out and go evangelize. There are great teams that are work with our church, so contact the church office on the number below. But please remember again to like, share and subscribe and share this with your family and friends. That's all for today. Thank you. Bye.